know.
They're that particular shade of blue. Like they've been made to gaze lovingly into my own eyes while I kiss you all night.
Stop right there!
Beat it, pal. I got here first.
Step aside, boy. I'm Captain Exposition. You can't do a play without me.
What? What are you talking about? Get out.
Relax, boy. They know they're in a play. This is non-realistic, experimental theater.
Oh?
Yes, you're just reciting words as if from a text, as wooden and memorized as a politician at a church meeting. And your audience knows it. But go ahead, I'll stay in the background.
Okay. Where were we?
You were about to tell me about my eyes.
Oh, yeah.
Why don't we just start everything over?
Sure. Hello.
Hi.
Is this seat taken?
No.
Mind if I sit down?
I guess, sure.
He sits, awkward and ashamed, realizing he has a blemish on his face and his hair is unkempt. He fears she'll think he's a nerd.
What do you think you're doing?
I'm Captain!
You know who you are. Look, pal, I'm trying to meet this girl here, okay?
Don't mind me.
But you've made a running commentary.
So you don't waste time with exposition during the dialogue.
Maybe I want to waste time.
Please! We're trying to do a play here.
And you're interrupting!
Nonsense! I'm vital to the audience's understanding of the conflict.
Would you like to go somewhere else?
He's not bothering me.
Oh. All right. I guess you can stay, but keep out of this, okay?
Go ahead.
Do you want to start over again?
Just start where you are.
Okay. So, can I buy you a drink?
He said, remembering how well the pickup line worked last time he wanted to get some airheaded bimbo.
What was that?
That's it, buddy. You're out of here.
Did he say that's a pickup line?
It's not a pickup line.
He said, remembering all the girls, dark and light, redheads and brunettes, blondes with big...
Would you shut up?
So that's all I am to you? Just some girl you pick up at a bar, use and abuse, and then toss aside like yesterday's garbage?
I'm not gonna toss you aside after... Look! You don't even know me. You have to give me a chance.
He lied, remembering the time his mother caught him with a Playboy magazine.
Will you shut up?
Let's talk. I want to hear more.
This is an exposition. This is deranged omniscient narration.
Deranged omniscient narration? No. That's my brother. Would you like me to call him?
I'm going to break your nose, buddy.
Leave me. I want him to stay.
Look, I'm striking out here. I don't even know your name. Yeah.
Well.
She tries the hair toss, knowing it will melt him like butter.
See?
See what? That didn't bother me.
Oh?
Did it?
Did it what?
Melt you like butter.
Maybe.
Maybe.
You'll have to find out.
She moves in for the kill, thinking of how she was stood up at the Valentine's dance and homecoming. That she didn't even have a date for the prom. That she made her little brother put on glasses and gel in his hair and drive her around town so that no one would know she didn't have a date. That she was a loser.
Let me out! I'll kill him!
I thought you didn't mind having him around.
Mind your business.
That's it, buddy. Now you have to leave.
Don't mind me. It's time for a new beat.
Huh?
And a sudden change of events or intentions or... the entrance of a new character.
Thanks for clearing that up.
Enter Miss Inciting Incident!
Hello, baby.
Let's just start the scene again.
Pardon me, good looking. Do you have an extra heart? I think you've stolen mine.
Excuse me?
Did anyone get the number on that car? A crime's been committed. I've been robbed of my senses.
Can you be any more lame?
So, babe, what are you having?
I have a screaming orgasm.
Make that too.
What are you? You little two-bit hussy!
Who's your friend?
What friend?
What friend?
She's nobody.
Nobody?
Just some girl.
What?
She yelled, having both a nervous breakdown and an epiphany at the same time. Her eyes fell to the Jacobian instrument of foreshadowing. foreshadowing lying on the table.
Why, look! A smoking gun!
Where?
There.
Now that's what you call just rewards.
Not exactly, because there's also a moment of Deus Ex Machina.
You mean a god of machine ending? He's not...
What luck! I just so happen to be wearing my bulletproof vest.
Son of a...
Yet this anticlimactic moment is followed by a tense moment of dramatic irony.
Irony? What's so ironic about it?
You mean this bulletproof vest right here?
Guess I took it off. Crap.
And that is that.
Nice climactic moment.
Yes, and a good big climax there to keep the audience guessing.
Exactly.
Now look what you've done. You're responsible for a cold-blooded murder.
Nonsense, you killed him yourself. I have witnesses.
One witness?
Well, true, one witness.
Witness to what?
What was that?
Oh, nice twist of fate. Brought on by your own hubris as Captain Exposition.
Hubris, I never.
Is that a police siren I hear?
Egad, but your fingerprints are all over that gun!
What gun?
That gun!
I don't see a gun.
That gun, you idiot, the one you just killed!
What gun?
This one!
Uh-oh, more dramatic irony.
There's nothing ironic about me holding this gun! Oh no!
Freeze!
Who? Me.
Put the gun down. And nobody deserved
it. It's not my gun.
Put it down, mister, or I'll shoot.
But I... In a sudden change of events, I turn from Captain Exposition into... the stock character film noir villain.
What?
You'll never take me alive!
Come on, mister. Put the gun down. Nice and easy. And nobody gets hurt.
Oh, help me, someone help me!
That's it. Easy. Easy.
You'll never take me alive, copper! It's getting darker. Darker.
Great. A stock death speech, too?
Whatever you do, just don't let the theater die, do you hear me? Don't let the theater die.
Poor guy. Struck with cliches and second-rate dialogue till the end. I guess it's time for a bit of denouement to me. I'll call the Greek chorus for some epilogue.